Hello and welcome to this new video on diffusion models. And we are going to train an image generator in PyTorch. We're going to the code line by line. I'm just going to start a few imports here and then I'm going to go over what we're going to do. So we will train the image generator on an image data set. Now you could use any image data set that you have, or you can import it. And what we are going to do here is we are creating some images that we store locally. These are rather small, 64 by 64 pixels, but we're going to make a training data set just for the purpose of demonstrating the diffusion model here. And that way you don't have to import anything or do any hassle of like getting the right data set. So this is essentially what we're going to be doing in these couple of next lines here. So here's, I'm just configuring a little bit the system. There's going to be a local folder data and then train going to be created on your system if you run these lines of code. Just be aware of it. Also, this is going to establish here whether you're going to be using a GPU or a CPU, depending on what's available. So here for this demo, I'm on a GPU and I also recommend that. Now, our training data set, as I mentioned, is something that we create locally. And what I thought is a good idea if we just make pictures of random circles, of random diameter and random position with a white background. And this is what these functions do here. So if I am running this, I'm creating these 300 images on my local system. And just to show you what that looks like, here's a function to plot them all. So we're going to have these circles as images. Now, this is to demonstrate this algorithm. Obviously, this doesn't need any training. We can just generate them by drawing them. But this is to demonstrate that we can actually train an algorithm that can make us circles like these. Now, for doing actual training, what's usually convenient to do is to put these images into a data set. So that's a PyTorch data structure, and that is a very good way of organizing your data so you can go through it during your training. And that's what we're going to be doing with our images. There's also one caveat. Our images are currently three channel images, red, green, and blue, and they have values from 0 to 255. And for this diffusion model to work, what we're going to have to do is we have to scale them into a range of -1 to 1. And the good thing is part of that is happening. If we transform an image into a tensor with this transform method, we're going to scale it to a range of 0 to 1. And if we then apply this quick arithmetic here, we'll have it from -1 to 1. And this is also one of the advantages of using data sets. We can kind of put these data transformations as a sequence in here, and then you have your training data set. So as I run that, it tells me now you have a data set based on a folder, 300 data points. There were some transformations happening. And just to demonstrate that a little bit, what we have here right now is, oh, I wanted to show you this first. So, okay, we have these images have pixels values from 0 to 225. And then after the transformation, you see the histogram of pixel values is ranging here from -1 to 1. And this is one example image tensor now. Now later, imagine we train our model and it will output image tensors. We need something to get back to an image, and that's what this function is doing here. So if we take in a tensor, it will put it back to the CPU. It will do some backward operations here on get it back to a RGB image with 255 values. And that's just to demonstrate we can put in a tensor and get our image back. So this was our training data set. and how we're going to use it and make it into tensors and so on and so forth. Now, for diffusion models, there are essentially three things happening. We are applying a noise to images, and this is a forward process. It is random because noise is involved, but it's actually a in a sense sequential and deterministic in terms of how we do it. Then we're going to train a model that would predict noises at each of these noise steps. And that model we will then use to start at complete noise and sequentially predict pieces of noise and subtract them from the image. And so here we are at stage one or part one, where we apply noise to image. And the noise, you've seen that in a way, is depending on if you have your image tensor at a certain step of that noise equation, there's usually a Gaussian noise applied where the mean is the previous tensor and the variance is that beta. It's scaled by that beta, and that beta is a number. And that number also depends on where in the step you are. So we're going from 0 to 200 steps, and every step along the way, we're going to increase the noise. This is in essence how we add noise. And there is a little bit of math involved that I didn't really want to dive in deep here. There usually comes out a nice compact equation that we can write a function upon, that if we want to have our noise at a step t based on the input image, then we just sample it from this normal distributions with these values here, alpha and the cumulative product of alpha. So this is it. And all this, if you don't want to dive deep into the math, will come into this function here. So now, if we imagine that we can noisify an image over 200 steps, then we can find our noise and our noisy image at any given time step t based on the input tensor. And so it will return us the noisy image and the particular noise in that particular time step. And just to demonstrate that here, of course I should run this. Just to demonstrate that here, this is what it would look like. We have our image of a circle that's clear, and then bit by bit we add noise, and all the way at the end we have complete noise. Now our goal would be to have a model that can go into any of these steps and predict the amount of noise added at that particular step. And we'll need, in essence, representations of what we're dealing with. The images, of course, are going to be represented in these tensors that we have. And our step in which we are, that's a number. But the number itself is not a suitable representation of the position. And so for that, we're going to be using a so-called sinusoidal position encoding. And I have a video on that, actually, you can check that out. But what it essentially does is it will transfer the number of 0 to 200 into a fixed dimensional vector. And that's something we can then add to the vectors that are going on in our model. And that way we can include this particular time location information into our model. We'll be using a UNet model, and UNet is called UNet because of its U shape. The way you have to imagine it is that we're going to be downsampling a tensor through convolution. So it's a convolutional neural network. And then once that convolution has happened over multiple steps, we're going to upsample it again via deconvolutions. And what that will do is that we'll have an output that is of the same dimension as the input. And that's very suitable for what we're doing here, because we will want to put in an input of a image tensor. And what we want is a tensor of that noise, so all the pixels that were added as noise in that particular time step. So that's why we're going to use a UNet model. And so UNet is composed of these blocks. So each of these blocks have transformation layers, convolution layers, and that transformation lambda depends on whether we are upsampling or downsampling. And that's why I made this abstract inherited structure here. So we have an abstract block, but we'll be using up blocks and down blocks for up and down sampling. And also you'll see here, we're going to have just a normal linear layer for the time encoding. So the UNet then itself we put together here. So we have three image channels, we have down channels. So this is the geometry of downsampling, upsampling, all the way back to upsampling back to our original image size. And then we can do that. So this is the architecture and the forward model. So in each case, we will have our time embedding in there, we downsample, we upsample, and then we have an output of the image. I want to try that. I'm actually going to execute that, so it's in my memory. So just to see what's going to happen. So we're going to have, positional encoding, we also have to load. So we take a tensor here, and it is of dimension, it's one image, three channels, and then 64 by 64 are the image dimensions. Now we are running it through a UNet that we just created. So we put the image tensor in and the time position. So here we just arbitrarily say we are at step 5. And what comes out is another tensor of the exact same dimension, right? So the ingoing one, x0 unsqueezed, was exactly the same dimension. So imagine now that UNet model is trained and we want to use it to generate an image. So of course, right now it is not trained. We're going to get to that in just a few minutes, but assume that we had a trained model. This is how we would be using it to generate images. So we'll be using the model to predict noise and then take that away from the image. And we'll be doing that in a sequence of basically 200 steps backwards. And then in the end, we'll have an image being generated out of it. So this is the flow of denoising using a particular model once we have a train. I'm going to just set that up here just to show you what it would give us right now. So it will give us 6 images and they should be coming clearer and more like a circle. But as you can see right now, it's just noise. And that is because the model that we're using is not trained. And that brings us to our next and last step here, where we'll have to train that model. For that, we'll be using a standard flow, several epochs, learning rate, atom optimizer. We're going to have our data loader based on the training set. And the details of how to run a normal deep learning flow, I also have a video and a notebook on that, so you can check that out. But this is pretty much it, right? So we have our model, which is our UNet, and then we're going to run that for 1,000 epochs. And now that we have started that, we can see that these epochs are showing us the loss, or basically because we see the loss for each epoch and it's decreasing. Now this will run for 1,000 epochs. I might make some cuts to this model in order to show you just the end of it and what it will look like. But for now, yeah, we can kind of watch that. And there will actually be, because the UNet is still relatively simple, it might not fully converge well after 1,000 epochs. You might have to train a little bit longer. And in fact, if we want to actually make more complex images, we will have to make the UNet even more sophisticated. For that, actually, feel free to leave me a comment if you would like me to go deeper into that and make more modification to the UNet and look a little bit more into hyperparameter tuning to work out how we can make an even better diffusion model. But this model should get us somewhere and should, you know, hopefully have helped you to understand the diffusion model process. And for now, I'm just going to wait this out, let this train and cut. We have completed 1000 epochs. It's still getting better, but this is some preliminary results. So we have here these stepwise denoisification. You see how you see some circles diffusing out of that. Now what's interesting, it looks like it will generate an image with two circles, whereas none of the images actually have that. So that's for now an interesting result. We could still further train this. We can still further improve the architecture. It looks like this would actually have to train for quite a while in order to make clear images. But as you can see, with this architecture, we can get somewhere. So once again, if you think you would like to see how to make the architecture of that UNet model more sophisticated, please let me know in the comments or contact me. I would really like to hear that, and I'm happy to dive into that. And in either case, I hope you enjoyed watching this video. I hope you learned something about diffusion models and how it all works together. And as usual, you can find the code on my GitHub. I put the link in there. And thanks again for watching.